me give you an example which is not a good one. I remember it from when I was serving Yugoslav army in 75-76. In Yugoslav constitution, it says that all languages of Yugoslav Federation are equal also in the army, which means Serbo-Croat, Slovene, Macedonian, Albanian. And that only in commandment the Serbo-Croat language should be used, which I accept. I mean, like, you cannot shout attack in all five languages or whatever. But that's all. But it was a nice example of unwritten rules how de facto in the army we all had to talk Serbo-Croat. If two of us Slovenes were caught talking among ourselves Slovene, we were immediately accused of nationalism, separatism, and so on and so on. Then at some political class, one of the soldiers asked the officer, comrade officer, whatever, isn't there a small contradiction here? We have to speak Serbo-Croat, but in constitution it says all languages, official languages, the four that I enumerated, are equal. What happened is that the officer simply told him, you are an idiot, you don't understand anything, if you ask a question like this again, you will be arrested. You see how, this is how ideology works in everyday life. It's not only that things are prohibited, the prohibition itself is prohibited. And I will make a jump now, I improvise a lot today. Trump is precisely violating this prohibition. For example, he tried to prove, I was quite shocked, in one of his TV interviews that his wife, Melania, who is Slovene, I'm proud to tell you, but I'm ashamed, that what a great lady she is. And she said something that, I don't want to use the dirty word, flatulence, you know, you eat too many beans or what. He said that never once in their marriage did he hear her emitting a sound of flatulence. You know what's the problem? The problem is that you don't say this, my God, you know. The vulgarity is not in doing this. The vulgarity is in even saying this. Or the same was with Hillary Clinton. Once Donald Trump made fun of her because she had to disappear for 3 minutes, probably taking a break for the toilet. And Trump said, I don't want even to imagine where she went, it's disgusting, and so on. No, sorry, we all do this. The disgusting thing is to mention this publicly. And Trump can do it, which is why he is, for me, one of the symbols of this, let's call it, disintegration of ethical substance. I claim that manners matter, because now you can say, but we have serious problems today, the threat of a new world war, ecological catastrophe, and so on. Why talk about manners? Here I am tempted to repeat, you know, De Quincey's famous quip about the simple art of murder, how many people began with a simple murder and ended up behaving badly at a table and so on. I'm tempted to say how many people began with unleashing terror and economic catastrophes and ended up behaving badly at the party. Because I think manners do matter. Sometimes precisely manners are the last thing that separates us from direct barbarism. And here I'm becoming a leftist moralist. I'm claiming that some of us are unfortunately old enough to remember the 60s, where it was, I remember, popular to use the F word, to talk a little bit brutally dirty, to denounce the hypocrisy of the official jargon. But now the right-wingers, populists, are talking like that. And I think the left should shamelessly use the chance and present itself as a defender of decency and public manners. We should be this today. Let me go on. Another very tricky topic at this level is Europe, Eurocentrism, and so on. I think that another leftist strategy today should be a qualified Eurocentrism. Why? Today, of course, I don't agree with right-wingers who claim our culture is threatened by Islam, by whoever. I fully admit that the greatest threat today to what is worth saving from European legacy are precisely our anti-immigrant populist defenders of Europe themselves. But we should nonetheless beware of something. If you look at a high-quality critique of dark aspects of European legacy, and there are many of them, don't forget that Holocaust, colonial horrors, even Gulag, these are ultimately results of European civilization. But if you look closely at it, we have to admit that the very position from which we criticize this, from which we are horrified at this, is a European one. Radical egalitarianism, feminism, and so on. The idea of us as abstract individuals, where ultimately it doesn't matter if you are men, women, and so on, is part of European legacy. All other cultures are basically organic. Organic in the sense that each of us at his, her, their proper place within the social edifice. And this is for me why criticism of Eurocentrism is so popular today. It's not something good. It's a very ominous sign of the fact that that capitalism is entering a new stage where it no longer needs universal emancipation, freedom, equality, and so on and so on.